Well, good afternoon. And thank you all for gathering online to come as we celebrate the life of a wonderful woman, Peggyanne Brocato. And we want to begin that celebration with this video presentation.
Hallelujah. needed proof. He saw her bathing on the roof, her beauty and the moonlight overthrew ya. She tied you to her kitchen chair, she broke your throne, and she cut your hair.
Well, in dying, Christ destroyed our death. In rising, Christ restored our life. Christ will come again in baptism. Christ will come again in glory. As in baptism, Peggy put on Christ, so in Christ may Peggy be clothed in glory. Hear these words of Jesus, who said, I am the resurrection and I am the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, yet shall they live, and whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. I died, and behold, I am alive forevermore, and I hold the keys of hell and death. Because I live, you shall live also. Friends and family, we've gathered this day to praise God, to witness to our faith as we celebrate the life of one very wonderful woman, Peggyanne Brocato. A wonderful woman, a wife, mother, someone who always had a smile on her face, someone who over those 100 years learned to look in the good in people and tell them about it. And so we come together this day with mixed emotions, and we acknowledge our loss and our pain and our doubts, and may God grant us grace that in pain we may find comfort, in sorrow, hope, and in death, resurrection. And hear these words from the psalmist, who recorded them in Psalm 91. She who dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. Surely He will save you from the fowler's snare and from the deadly pestilence. He will cover you with his feathers, and under his wings you will find refuge. His faithfulness will be your shield and rampart. You will not fear the terror of the night, nor the arrow that flies by day, nor the pestilence that stalks in the darkness, nor the plague that destroys at midday. 1,000 may fall at your side, 10,000 at your right hand, but it will not come near you. Because she loves me, says the Lord, I will rescue her. I will protect her. For she acknowledges my name. She will call upon me, and I will answer her. I will be with her in trouble. I will deliver her and honor her. With long life, I will satisfy her and show her my salvation. Let us pray. Eternal God, we praise you for that great company of all those who have finished their course in faith and now rest from their labor. Lord, we praise you for those dear to us whom we name in our hearts before you. Especially, we praise you for Peggy, whom you have graciously received into your presence. Lord, to all of these, grant your peace. Let your perpetual light shine upon them. And Lord, help us so to believe where we have not seen, that your presence may lead us through our years and bring us at last with them into the joy of your home that they know, which is not made with hands, but eternal in the heavens through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And hear these words from Proverbs, the 16th chapter. Whoever gives heed to instructions prospers, and blessed is he who trusts in the Lord. The wise in heart are called discerning, and pleasant words promote instruction. Understanding is a fountain of life to those who have it, but folly brings punishment to fools. A wise person's heart guides his mouth, and his lips promote instruction. Pleasant words are a honeycomb, sweet to the soul and healing to the bones. Well, this time we're going to invite Candace up to come share some words.
Probably can't see me over this thing. There are some family members that couldn't be with us today. And one of them is our Aunt Bibi, who we adore and has been a part of our family, my mother's life, since she was 10 years old. So she wrote me some words, and she asked me if I wouldn't mind reading this for her today. Pegasus, you are still alive as I am writing this, but it wouldn't be much longer. And for the first time in my life, you won't be a part of it. Our world will be a different place without you. You were 16 when I was born, a high school student in Ellsworth, Maine, where you were living with your maternal grandparents. It was a peaceful, rural life, and you were excited at the prospect of going to college. There wasn't a lot of money. The country was still in a depression. But you had gumption, earned scholarships, and you took yourself to college. My first memories of you were in college, and you would bring your girlfriends home. Your bedroom was next to mine, and how I wished I was in there laughing with you and your friends. I couldn't understand the words, so I would try to listen with a glass and my ear. However, I did understand that something important was happening when you brought Walter Brocato, a fellow student, and his parents to meet my mom and dad. All the aunts were crazy about Peggy, and they always referred to her as pretty Peggy, because she was. The U.S. entered World War II, and Peg and Walter were married. She was a wartime bride in San Antonio, Texas. Her husband, a cadet in the U.S. Army Air Corps, Walter was sent to the Philippines, and Peg and her baby Suzanne came to live with my parents. I was 10, and I already had what was to be a lifetime crush on my cousin Walter. I secretly thought Susie was mine. Evenings, Peg would sit at the dining room table writing Walter, and I would try to speak, take a peek, and see what she was writing. After the war, they lived down the street from us. I must have driven them crazy with my constant presence, but they never let on. Walter, a pilot to his bone marrow, went back to the Air Force. I was growing up. The Brocatos had two assignments to Japan. Our lives continued through long letters. Now there were two more daughters, Candace and Sherry. Eventually, they returned to Florida. That's when the visits began anew, and they never really stopped. We moved to Miami. It was a long drive, but it didn't slow down the trips. Weekends at football games, New Year's Eve parties, Orange Bowl parties, trips that Pegas and I made with my mom, Peg's Aunt Margie. There were visits to Disney World when our kids were young. We'd be living in a big blue tent, and Peg would teach the little girls white glove manners as they sat in the dust in the tent. My kids so loved these trips with Peg that one Christmas they put all their change together to buy her favorite beverage. They told me that I would find it in a blue velvet bag at the liquor store. Once we were in Jamaica in a little hotel with a loud bunch of partying German men. They had already spotted Peg, so when we went to bed that night, we shoved a big dresser against the door. Sure enough, someone tried to enter our room about 2 a.m. They didn't make it. On the same trip, we were climbing up Dunn's River Falls when a very young, handsome man walked up and said he wanted to kiss Peg. And he did. And to her amazement, he did. And to all our laughter. Then he ran off. We loved visiting Prince Edward's Island, where our family first arrived in the 1700s from the Isle of Skye, Scotland. It wasn't the genealogy that attracted us. It was the clam chowder, the white kind. We had it all, three meals for 3 days. Just a few years ago, Peg and her friend Jerry Ann flew to California, where they met Susie and me, and we all drove across the desert to visit Sherry and Aaron at their mountain cabin in Utah. It took days to sweep out the crumbs from the SUV. We literally ate our way through three states. Peg's last long trip was to Memphis to dance at Cousin Beau's and Irene's wedding. And dance she did. No wildflower was she. So many trips, so many years ago, and so many years since a young, pretty girl took the train across the country to marry her handsome beau. That bride sent her husband off to three wars. She raised three marvelous daughters with and without their father. She packed up her household and moved so many times. Just a minute, I'm gonna do it. And still found time to put in hundreds of hours volunteering to help other families. She was an amazing woman, my cousin Pegas. She didn't just live in this world. She made it better. Peggyanne Brocato wasn't just a visitor to this world. She was a much loved and successful participant for 101 years. And that was written by the Ferris Claire.
Thank you, Candace. And to those who are watching, as soon as the family is finished making their remarks, if you would put a comment on the Facebook feed, I will read some of those. Keep them short. We're not looking for 15-minute epistles. Just little snapshots of the wonderful woman she was. So this time, we invite Sherry to come forward.
My mother read me bedtime stories. Early on, Mom would read me nursery books, and then the bedtime stories featuring all the golden books ever written. Later, Dr. Seuss, and then on to the more complex stories like Grimm's Fairy Tales, Charlotte's Web, The Wizard of Oz, and on to the writings of Robert Louis Stevenson, A Child's Garden of Verses, and the list goes on. My childhood nocturnal reading demands became not just one story, but two, and then three, until Mom handed me a flashlight and told me to read myself to sleep. But those particular nights, reading myself to sleep didn't deliver the same nocturnal deep sleep that my mother's readings gave me. Her sweet, patient readings were not about the plots and the characters or the endings, which I never wanted her to reach. It was about my mom reading to me, the snuggle time, the intensity of the various voices she would conjure up, and the one-on-one quiet times we shared. Sometimes we would discuss the stories or characters, but that was just one of my clever stall tactics, usually coming at the almost end of a story when I didn't want it to end, because then it was lights out. Not to be undone, I now know Mom devised her own tactics as a gentle way of ending her story bedtime reading to me. Mom began to challenge me to look up words I did not know in the dictionary. And then she would ask me to spell that word, and then I had to use it in a sentence. Mom was a very smart woman. My mom was a genius at finding games and activities I enjoyed that would teach me valuable lessons and important life skills. My mother and I played another game before I went to sleep, which was another stall tactic for me. The rules were simple. We would take turns saying that we loved each other more than something. For example, she would say, "I love you more than your baby doll." And then it was my turn. It was my task to return the sentiment by saying, "I loved her more than something larger than my baby doll." So I would say, "I love you more than the kitchen table." And so it went. We would continue in this vein until the game was over by default when someone sang the magic words, "Well, I love you more than infinity." Then the game was over, we'd kiss goodnight, and I would sleep. What I didn't realize at the time was that my mother was teaching me about shapes and sizes and how to use my imagination and to turn my imagination into words and then sentences. The game was also about learning to comprehend the magnitude of my mother's feelings for me as much as it was about being together and laughing about the goofy things we'd come up with. I love you more than a tennis racket, I love you more than a gorilla, and so forth. And we laughed. My mother and I loved to laugh. She said I was funny. She was the first to laugh at my antics and off-color jokes. Many of you here today, and I know my sisters will remember, one Christmas Eve right here in this church, that we could not finish singing the beautiful song, Emmanuel, due to something irreverent I did or said, I don't remember now. Well, we had a blast singing Emmanuel all the way home, big and loud, in the car going home, my father cringing, and my mother howling with laughter. Still to this day, we can't get through a Christmas Eve without thinking and laughing and smiling about Emmanuel. How incredibly strong was my mother? Did I know anyone stronger? She never gave up. She never gave up. She put her entire being into raising the three of us Air Force brats, along with our dad, providing us and making any house we moved into, making it a real home for us. Always we were in a new home. It was never a house, wherever we were, anywhere in the world. I'm writing this shortly before her death, knowing that my strength and her strength will get me through this. As my mother always said to me, it's amazing how strong you can be when you have no other choice. I tried several times to convince Mom that those lessons of strength will get me through this that she taught me. As my mother always said, I've tried several times to convince her that those lessons were already taught, the wisdom imparted. But she continued to worry and concern herself mostly on how all of us would handle this, how we would move forward after this devastating loss, the toll it would take, and the tears we would cry. There are really no words to describe our closeness to our mother. I know this because as the years went by, after my father died, and after celebrating Mom's 101st birthday 2 months ago, forces even the most optimistic and hopeful of us to think about and plan for this day. And as such, I started thinking about what I would say during a time like this. And after unsuccessfully putting pen to paper several times, I realized there really are no words. Mom would have said, "Look some up." Now there are only feelings, indescribable feelings, feelings that make my heart burst and my whole being melt. because my mother was my confidence, my bravery and strength. And without a doubt, Mom gave me my love of reading, words, and books. If I had to conjure up one life lesson that she would want me to carry for the rest of my life, it is this: seek advice from others, but always trust yourself. She believed in me. She believed that I always knew what was best for me. And as the years went by, she trusted me to know what was good for her. And if I had to conjure up a second lesson or personal desire of hers, it would be a plea for me to read another book, read a dozen books, maybe even write one, and laugh a lot. Mom, I will continue to read. I will maybe try to write a book, and I will laugh again, but it will never be the same. I love you more than infinity, Mom. I love you forever. Be happy back in the loving arms of our dad.
Thank you, Siri, for those wonderful words. This time, Susie would come forward.
As most of you know that have been here before, I don't like microphones, so I think you all can hear me. You've heard us say today, love you forever. And it's very common in our family to say that. And I want to thank you all for coming to be with us this afternoon, all 20 of you. We appreciate that. And also everyone that's watching live on Facebook and will later watch on YouTube. That's be available later today. My mother's goodbye to my sisters, myself, and her friends was always love you forever. Now, you're going to hear this several times today, I think. But it's true. And I'd like to say to all of you, love you forever. And one more day. Thank you for coming to be with us. And Cheryl, thank you for being a part of my mom's life. You helped to make it a wonderful life. Thank you.
Thank you, Susie. And Candace is now going to come back and share her heart.
So when I came up here earlier, I forgot to say the introduction, and I apologize for that, so I'm going to say it now. Good afternoon, and thank you for coming. For the celebration of life today. And in spite of the coronavirus, I know that those of you that are here in the chapel are sitting 6 feet apart, and those watching at home, this all means the world to Mom and to me. Had it not been for COVID-19, we would all be dancing in the streets with a big band, whooping it up, which Mom would have loved and wanted. But instead, today, Mom is with my dad and her Heavenly Father, smiling at us from above, feeling no pain or sadness. And I'm certain she is sending love and gratitude to all of us today, because that's Mom's way, always thinking of others first. Many, or most of you, at one time or another, have received a voicemail message from my mom. She wasn't exactly tech savvy, but she got the gist across. I want to share with you how a message from my mother would go when she would call me. It would go like this: hello, and then there'd be a pause. This is your mother, and a pause, and then she'd say, Peggy, as if I had another mother. And then she would say, you must not be home. I'll talk for a few minutes and give you time to hear my voice and come to the phone. And then there'd be a long pause and breathing. And then she'd say, okay, I guess you're not there. You must be gallivanting around doing something fun, or maybe you are decorating a house or having a glass of wine with your friends. Now remember, this was at 1 o'clock in the afternoon.
and she thinks I might be out at happy hour. Then she would say, I guess you really are not there, so I will let you go and get on with your day. I just wanted to tell you that I was thinking about you and that I love you dearly. You don't have to call me back because I know you're busy, and I know you'll call me back anyway. Then she would continue talking, and she'd say, oh, I want you to have a lovely sun-filled day, and remember I love you. Oh, did I tell you? This is your mom, Peggy. Then she would hang up, and my heart would be filled with love for her and her cuteness, as always. Then the phone would ring again. Hello? This is your mother. Peggy, I think I told you you didn't have to call me back, but I didn't mean that. I do want you to call me back because I want to hear your voice and not just the voice on the box. My mother may not have been very tech savvy, but she was savvy in every other way. She loved her family and friends. She thought of others before herself. She would do anything for anyone, and she did up to the days before her angel wings ride to heaven. Days before the fall, she called 20 or 30 people on the phone to see how they were doing during COVID-19 because they were shut in. She had a kind word of hope and love for everyone. My mom, Peggy, was thoughtful, kind, generous, upbeat, adorable, uplifting, and beautiful inside and out. She had a keen sense of style and panache. She smiled at everyone. Until the day she fell, she was still applying her own makeup with a steady hand and getting herself up in the morning and to bed at night, and assisted in emptying the dishwasher and other home chores. Imagine, 101 years old and still full of pep and vigor. I know 60-year-olds that my mom could run circles around, including me. I want to end with a letter I wrote to my mom in 1996. Dear Mom, I had no choice in selecting my mom, but God blessed me with you. God must love me very much to have placed me in your loving arms. Mom, you have always steered me in the right direction. Everything I am is because of you. I cannot imagine a world without you, your love, and your guidance, and your grace. In your tender, caring love, I have found so much solace and comfort. You made every home a place I always looked forward to coming home to. What made it home was you and Dad. The country we lived in or the state we lived in didn't matter. I love you, Mom. These three little words. I hope they will fill your heart with happiness, just as my heart is filled with happiness because of your love for me, which is a special love that only a mother is capable of giving. Love, Candy. And now in closing, my mother, also my best friend, will live in my heart forever. She will also live in the hearts of my son, Scotty, and my dearest grandboys, Tyler and Rylan, and Scott's beautiful wife, Kimberly, and her children, Keely and Darby, and also in the heart of my dear friend, Dan. My prayer is that Mom will always live in all of your hearts as well. And thank you so much for being here today with us at this celebration of life for my beautiful mom. And just in case you missed it, there was a picture on the back, so she was helping me.
Thank you, Candace. And Karen will come forward now to speak.
Hi. As most of you know, I was Peggy's caregiver for 7 years. It seems like a lifetime, in a good way. Peggy had a way of leaving a lasting impression on all of us. I would like to share one of those moments with you that left a lasting impression on me. One day, we were organizing her jewelry, of which she had a lot. Walter and the girls had given her many treasures, and as we organized them and put them in their proper place, she would love to tell the stories that many of the pieces had. And after we were finished and we put them all away, I asked Peggy, I said, of all the valued gifts and treasures that Walter gave you, which one do you value the most? And she stopped for a minute and had this look on her face. And she said, Walter always made me feel important. Wow, okay, I wasn't expecting that answer. I was expecting the beautiful necklace or the diamond bracelet. I was expecting her to say anything but what she did. But it was thought-provoking. I realized it's very true. The most important gift that we can give anyone is to value them and make them feel important in our lives. I know Peggy made me feel important in hers. So Peggy taught white gloves and party manners at Dillard's, and obviously way before that, now that I learn. So she taught in her younger years, and as she continued to teach us life lessons in her later years. I think this one memory that I had of Peggy putting that jewelry away was one of her lessons. I would like a moment to share a small poem written by Linda Ellis, and it's called The Dash, that relates so much to this lesson that I'd like to share it with you. I read of a man who stood to speak at a funeral of a friend. He referred to the dates on the tombstone from the beginning to the end. The first he noted came the birth and spoke of the following date with tears. But he said most important was that dash between the years. For that dash represented all the time that she spent alive here on earth. And now only those who loved her knew what that little dash was worth. For it matters not how much we own, the cars, the house, the cash. What matters most is how we love and live and how we spend our dash. So think about it long and hard. Are there things you'd like to change? For you never know how much time is left that can still be rearranged. If we could just slow down enough to consider what's true and real and always try to understand the way other people feel and be less quick to anger and show appreciation more and love the people in our lives like we never loved before. If we treat each other with respect and more often wear a smile, remembering this special dash may last just a little while. So when your eulogy is being read with your life actions to rehash, would you be proud of the things they say about how you spent your dash? I am sure that Peggy would have been proud how she spent her dash. 101, she doesn't deserve a dash, she deserves a line. She was beautiful inside and out. She is now gone. But it will be impossible to forget her.
Thank you so much. And we've had lots of people tuning in online. And see if I can figure this out with my technology. I used to do technology good, then I became a pastor. My wife writes, my tribute to Peggy. I loved her sense of joyful anticipation. She wasn't just cheerful and happy. She went beyond those things to an expectation that she was going to experience something good everywhere she went. So amazing to live 101 years and not get bored with life. Kay McClure writes, we will always remember our precious bunny, pink ears, bunny pink ears, Miss Piggy. She will always be remembered as such a lovely, gracious, okay, it popped because someone else wrote. It's tough when someone else posts something, then everything moves up. Okay, so if I can figure this out, it's not giving me the whole list. Cynthia Whithum writes, when I think of the words grace or lady, I see Peggy. She lived a life filled with grace and was always the perfect lady. The last time I got to see Peggy was when we all celebrated her birthday at the Blue Coyote. I think it was her 97th. She had so much fun and out-partied us all. What a beautiful legacy she has for her three girls and all their families. I'm sure she's dancing in pearls and gloves in heaven. Terry Bernhardt writes, Mom and I will also miss Peggy's latest cute outfits. Some of you expect to see on someone in their 20s, yet in Peggy, they looked age-appropriate and fantastic. Kimberly Jester writes, we are raising a toast of champagne for you today, sweet Nan. We love you forever. And why it will not give me the rest of the feed, I do not know. Because there's 28 people have commented, and I can only see four. Can you see any more back there, Joanne? Hope it just flipped off. Lil Moore wrote, she was our church's goodwill ambassador, always greeting with a smile and positive comments for all. Joy Johns writes, Mom B, thank you for being my second mom. I love you forever. Kimberly Jester writes, love you forever. Scott, Kimberly, Tyler, Ryan, Keeley, and Darby. I was hoping to be able to read these in a nice thing, but I think when you get home, y'all will be able to read down these, the wonderful love that is coming forth and the number of people that are watching online as we do these weird things in these weird times, and I'm sure Peggy is getting a tickle out of it. Well, one of the things I enjoy doing is researching stories behind many of the hymns we sing. These stories that inspired many of our hymns are wonderful witnesses to the people who wrote them. As I thought about Peggy and how she loved to listen to music, she would always come up after the end of the service to speak to our pianist and to tell her how wonderful she is. And the music she gives is so beautiful. I thought about this story about Professor William J. Kirkpatrick. He wrote the music to several favorite hymns, such as Jesus Saves, Redeemed, How I Love to Proclaim It, And 'tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, and he hideth my soul. Well, it was on an evening of 1921 that he told his wife that there was a song that he had been running through his mind all day long. He says, I gotta write it down before I forget it. And his wife was accustomed to him going off into his study late at night and not coming bed till late. So she went on to bed. Well, later after midnight, she awoke. And seeing the light still burning in the study, she went in to investigate. And she found him at his desk. He had gone on to glory, but pencil was still in his hand. And spread before him were some pages of paper upon which he penned these lines. Coming home, never more to roam. Open wide thy arms of love, Lord, I'm coming home. That is why we gather to celebrate and remember this day, that Peggy has come home to the Lord after a very long and fruitful and wonderful life. And so we can celebrate today. We celebrate not just that, but the person who she is. Some people would say was, but she still is. She's still going. She's the Energizer Bunny. Peggy was a walking bundle of joy that just made you smile and forget about your troubles. She was given a rare gift of love. In Psalm 100, it's one of the first psalms I ever memorized as a kid. In the Episcopal Church, we used to chant it a little bit. But I love the words, shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness and come before him with joyful songs. And it goes on to say, enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name, for the Lord is good and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations. And so we come this morning knowing that Peggy is entering the gates of heaven with a song. She's probably dancing a little too. But she has entered the gates of heaven, and I know she has entered them singing a new song. Singing a song that one can only sing the other side of this world. See, on this side of heaven, our songs are filled with emphasis on trust, on faith, on hope. And these songs help us to live our lives. Sermons are okay. I mean, the preacher up there is the same thing. But songs are what lift us up. They point us to the truths of God. And one of those truths that Peggy found, I believe, was in Psalm 91. Listen to the song it sings. She who dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. And then the song expresses the reason for the need of a fortress, a shelter. The psalmist said, surely he will save you from the fowler's snare and from the deadly pestilence. He will cover you with his feathers. And under his wings you will find refuge. His faithfulness will be your shield and your rampart. You will not fear the terror of the night, nor the arrow that flies by the day, nor the pestilence that stalks in the darkness, nor the plague that destroys at midday. Even with all this stuff in the world, you just live. And she knew that. And she wanted to convey that to all she met. See, on this side of heaven, we deal with deadly pestilence, the terrors of the night. We are seeing that really so clearly today. Yet even with all the pain, one cannot live life without seeing some pain. Peggy always remained positive. I know what it means to move around. I grew up in a military household where my dad was in for 30 years, knowing different schools, different homes, and a mom who just, okay. Of course, my mom always asked my dad when we were moving, are we going to get more money? And if he said yes, then she was okay with the move. See, as military wives, you learn that steadfastness of moving forward. And she remained steadfast in her belief in God. and in the song she sang here on earth. But she loved to be in church. She loved to be around people. She was a people person. She understood what it meant, though, to dwell with God in his house, even as we live on this earth. And when we couldn't come on Sundays, she missed it. She missed the whole of it. But she also learned what the writer of Proverbs taught. Pleasant words are a honeycomb, sweet to the soul and healing to the bones. That has been a constant theme from all who shared stories about Peggy to me. She was filled with pleasant words that were sweet to people's souls. I don't think there was a Sunday where she was present that she didn't have to get to me after church to tell me how wonderful it was today, even when I knew it wasn't wonderful. When I knew I didn't give my best, she would, "Oh, that was the best you've ever done." She would send me cards. In fact, she sent a card to me just a few weeks ago, trying to encourage me, knowing this mess we are in will end and we will once again all be back together and our hearts will be glad. She did her best to live the full essence of what Jesus taught. She leaned on Christ for her support. And as I thought about her faith and how wonderful she was and charming and beautiful, I couldn't help but think of this story someone once told. It was about a man who stood on a shore and he was looking at a wonderful ship, one of those beautiful ships from old, and it was leaving the harbor. And as the people on the shore, they watched, they could see the ship spread her white sails in the morning breeze and began to move swiftly out to the blue ocean. She was an object of beauty and strength. And as they stood and watched, the ship began to become less and less visible as it went out to sea, just to the point where it became just a white speck mingled with the clouds when it reached that last point. And someone would yell out, "Look, she's gone." But gone where? Gone from our sight, that's all. She is just as large in mass and hull as she ever was, just as beautiful. Her diminutive size lies in the viewer, not in her. Because at the very moment when someone yells, "Look, she's gone," there are other eyes eagerly watching her approach, and other voices ready to take up the glad shout, "Look, she's coming." And that's what we celebrate today. Those loud voices saying, "Look, she's coming home." And that is... it is with us in death and with Peggy. She is still the same wonderful, full of life person who welcomes you and lets you know how wonderful you are. And that is who we remember here. Not the image of the ship that sailed far away where we could hardly recognize it. We remember the beautiful person Peggyanne is, who we were blessed to have known in this time, who sang a song of faith that was a witness to all who were around her, and is now welcome to that final home of peace with all who have gone on before her. This is not the end. It's a new beginning with a new song. I think Winston Churchill summed it up in a unique way at his funeral. There's a story about his funeral in which preparations actually began for Winston Churchill's funeral about 8 years before he died. And it took place in St. Paul's Cathedral, It included many of the wonderful hymns of the Anglican Church. But the ending music was a little different. In this country, at the end of many services, if you go to Arlington or any national cemetery, you will hear the bugler playing taps as that final song. Well, in England, the song they play is "Last Post." It's a bugle call for the last hours of the day. And it's done at many memorials and gravesides. But Winston Churchill did something different, or he asked for something different. There's a bugler high up in the whispering gallery playing out "Last Post." And as soon as the words ended, or the song ended for "Last Post," The bugler immediately went into reveille. It's time to get up. They said Winston Churchill never wanted the last word to be taps. And I think Peggy Ann would say the last words are not taps. It's time to get going. There's things to do. There's people to love. That's what she wants us to do. It's time to get going. Let us pray. Oh, gracious Heavenly Father, into your hands we commend your servant Peggy. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive, God, into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, into the glorious company of the saints of light. And God of love, we thank you for all of which you have blessed us, even to this day, for the gift of joy in days of health and strength, and for the gifts of your abiding presence and promise in days of pain and grief. We praise you for home and for friends and for our baptism, and our place in your church with all who have faithfully lived and died. And Lord, above all else, we thank you for Jesus Christ, who knew our griefs, who died our death and rose for our sake, and who lives and prays for us. And as he had taught us, let us join together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now may the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named, according to the riches of God's glory, grant you to be strengthened with might through God's Spirit, that in your inner being, that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, and that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth, the length, the height, and the depth, and to know the love of Christ, which surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Amen. Amen. And this concludes our service for those who have joined us online. Thank you for tuning in.